here to so much teach you that as to find out from you how you might do that or how you have done that, and hopefully we can learn from each other. Really, my job today is to show you my failures, how I have failed at this, and how I've learned going forward, because I've certainly done that many times. Most recently, the last 3 years, as President mentioned, I was appointed by the mayor in July of 2016 to lead the Cedar City Police Force, which was humbling. It's funny how, and some of you may have experienced this, and those who have not will, that you get to a point in a career, and as you move up the ladder, you think you know what lies ahead, right? Oftentimes, it's not what you thought. And that was certainly the case. And I don't know how you prepare for certain things like that. So it's been a very humbling experience these last 3 years. So hopefully we can mix some temporal leadership skills and a couple of activities with the spiritual side of things. And we can kind of zero down on the things that I've learned on how to truly lead people and what works. And what I have found after many years in law enforcement, and particularly the last 3 years, is it's not quite what I thought it was. And there are facets to leadership. But I think the most important thing that we talk about is there's a difference, right? How many people in here supervise other people currently in a job or have done that before? Okay. So I'm just going to ask maybe a couple questions, and feel free to chime in, especially those that raise their hands. President, we'll start with you. In your mind, and it has, maybe it can just be one or two words. There's management and there's leadership, right?
Yeah.
In your mind, is there a difference? And if so, what is that difference in a few words?
Well, I think there is a difference, at least in my experience, because the first time I was meeting someone, I had four department supervisors below me and 28 employees. And for me, it was difficult to balance letting those department supervisors take care of their duties. And probably the greatest difficulty for me was to provide an enjoyable work environment, but still under the rules and regulations, particularly of safety for the company.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Who else? Raise your hand. Brother Mankel, what do you think?
Leadership is taking people places, and management is handling things.
Okay.
Man and management is hand handling things.
Yeah. Well put. Thank you. Brother Sanders?
I would say as well, it's a difference between telling and teaching.
Okay.
You know, like
good.
When you're a manager, you kind of tell people what to do. When you're a leader, you teach people how to do.
I like that.
You know, help them in the process.
Okay, good. Peter, did you raise your hand?
Yeah, what comes to my mind is the difference between administering and ministering.
Yes.
I feel like leadership has a lot more to do with the one-on-one relationship.
Perfect, I love it. Yes, Brother Gilmore.
Well, I think leadership doesn't necessarily have to be a position. I think management really is just a position title, whereas leadership can come from wherever.
Absolutely, well said, thank you. Who else? Anybody else raise their hand? Yeah.
I think one of the things with me was basically getting to know the people that I worked with and that I was in charge of, because everybody's a different individual.
Yeah.
And you need to know their life.
Yes.
So to speak.
You guys are teaching this for me. You're awesome. And the wisdom speaks right there. And that is so true. Getting to know those people you lead intimately so that you can address those issues. I've often told my staff, lieutenants and the sergeants, because oftentimes they'll come and say, you know, this officer's doing this or he's doing that, and it's so frustrating. And my response as a manager is, well, you have to hold them accountable. If you're going to allow that to occur, then you're going to be the one frustrated, so you have nobody to blame but yourself. But the other side of that is the leadership. You've got to get to know your crew, and we typically have between 5 and 6 on a crew, to know their wants and their desires and their frustrations and those things that make them tick, so you can lead them. Because you can tell them all day, you know, car cleaned out, or handle this call this way, or don't be late. But unless you look at them as individuals and find out what the root cause of some of that behavior is, you're never going to be able to lead them appropriately. So that's great. All those answers, perfect. Scouters in here, remember the EDGE method? Does anybody remember what EDGE stands for? If you do, raise your hand. Let's see if you can take a stab at it. Another book cup.
Explain, demonstrate, guide, and enable.
Oh, perfect. A plus. So, explain, right? And leadership is about that. Somebody mentioned that teaching. We're going to explain, we're going to demonstrate, and we're not going to do a form, we're going to guide them, and then, of course, that last step is enable. And that is so important. Okay, so let's delve a little bit here. I've got a quote, and I want to take this just a little slowly so we can write it on the board. Brother Plu, would you read this? And I'm going to stop it as we go a little bit. If you'll read that loud and a little bit slow.
There is a stark contrast between the worst leaders in the world and the perfect leader, the savior of the world. President Spencer W. Kimball explained, those leaders in history who have been most tragic in their impact on mankind were tragic precisely because they lacked, to almost any degree, the qualities of the man of Galilee. Where Jesus was selfless, they were selfish.
Okay, hold on there. So where Jesus was, what was that, selfless?
Yeah.
They were
selfish.
Okay?
Where Jesus was concerned with freedom, they were concerned with control.
Okay? So, freedom and control.
Where Jesus was concerned with service, they were concerned with status. Sought to manipulate morals. Where Jesus was filled with compassion balanced by justice, they have so often harshness.
Is that the end?
That's the end.
Okay, perfect. So is that surprising to anyone? No? So that was a lesson that I had to learn, honestly. And for all of us, we're shaped differently, right, throughout our life, throughout our career. When I served, from a temple perspective, when I served under my predecessor, he exemplified a lot of these qualities. But we had a few examples or a few incidents of misconduct that fell directly to me to take care of. And so as I look back now, I think to myself that maybe the rut that I got into was that I was trying to protect the organization and doing the right thing by investigating and holding people accountable, but I did it more from a managerial standpoint. I had a discipline issue about a year ago, and one of the officers came in and he taught me a great lesson, and that's where I really tried to humble myself and realize, okay, just because I'm the boss doesn't mean I have to rule with an iron fist. Not that I really ever did, but I was trying to balance management with leadership, and the allegation was fairly serious, and it had to be reviewed by the county attorney for criminal charges to be at least reviewed on this officer, which was hard. And it was just robotic when I did it, because I'd had those experiences before with those other two many years ago. It was just all administrative, and I was given a task, and I tried to do it to perfection. But now, it was a little bit different. And so one of those involved officers had come up and he said, you know, it would mean so much to know that you have our backs if you could just come and have a conversation with us. And that was a little foreign to me because, again, when an allegation comes, you go through the motions and you try to keep some separation so in the event of a discipline or termination, that there is a clear delineation. And that is so untrue. I mean, we don't have to be like that. And so his advice simply was this. He said, it would have been great if you could have just come down and said, hey, this is terrible, you know, nobody likes it, we've got your back, we're gonna get through this, and whatever happens, happens, but we're here for you. And he said that would have made so much difference for this individual. And I thought, you know, he's right. There's no reason why I could not have done that. And so I used that as a learning lesson. And just a few weeks ago, as we often do, as you can imagine, we get complaints quite often. Well, I shouldn't say quite often, but routinely, because a citizen may think that we didn't do the job that they'd expected, which sometimes is very true. And this particular officer, you know, he's military, he's very by the book, and he communicated with the citizen in a more of a kind of a curt and impatient way, non-sensitive way, which was really unnecessary. So I thought, okay, I'm gonna try this. So I brought him in, I just said, hey, this is where we're at. You know, there's a complaint. I just want to give you kind of the details of where we're at. And just gave him some advice. I said, I think you did a great job, but maybe think about next time just tweaking this enough to where it makes a difference in the perception of the person you're serving, because that's what we are. We're servants. We're public servants. And he took that. He says, yeah, that's a good point. I think I could have done better. But I think the collateral, as I talked to him and others later, he expressed, he said, I appreciate you bringing me in face-to-face and talking to me about that. It meant a lot. And it just gave more credibility and tightened that relationship. And it really was an eye-opener for me to realize, okay, we can be human and we can be Christ-like and have these attributes, as we should, and lead people. In fact, we'll lead them much greater than we would otherwise. So selflessness, giving them freedom instead of control, service, serving others is so key. Making sure we have the needs of others, development and compassion. I see that as a big role for me, and I think that's a role for us, right, as priesthood leaders, is that we should, as we develop ourselves, develop those around us, or at least support their development, and especially our youth. With the changes recently with the Aaronic priesthood, the bishop will tell you it's been a little bit of a learning experience for us, to where we now have complete authority and oversight of our youth, which the bishop always has. But I think now the prophet and the Lord has said it's time to really put this into action, and you guys need to be engaged. So that falls on us and the advisor and the specialist that we have called to help develop these young men, to try to lead and guide and teach, not compel. Let them fall, let them make mistakes, show them how they can improve, and then lead them as we develop their skills and their talents and abilities toward adulthood. So a big part of leadership, I think, is communication, right? Would anybody disagree with that? We need to listen, we need to hear, we need to communicate, and we also need to follow the Spirit. I think that's important. So I guess, not that I need to give you permission, but I would hope in your occupations, in your life with your family, I assume that you do this already and you do it very well. But especially in your temporal occupation, that you will employ the Lord and that you will talk to him and communicate with him consistently. That's one thing I've always tried to do as far back as I can remember in my career with every major decision. And I see where in some minor decisions I should have done this as well, and I didn't. But every major decision I have knelt and asked the Lord for guidance. And it has served me well. So I guess my point is don't be afraid, don't. As you gain knowledge, I'm sure, Brother Sorensen, you're going to be a great podiatrist, and you're going to be skilled, and you're going to be a master at what you do.
I hope so.
But there will be times when you'll be inclined to lean onto your own understanding, and knowing you, you won't. You'll call on the Lord, because that's who you are. But that will be necessary in our jobs to be able to do that. I'll just give you an example of where I failed. Years ago, we had a youth conference. I was in a Bishop Rick Amenik, and we took the youth to a beautiful camp up by Kolob Reservoir. And it's what I learned then was that it was a piece of property that was owned by a Nevada stake, and they would generally use that. And we got to use it in the pine trees. It was beautiful. And so we went up, and we did rotation activities. So we would take the youth to this place and to this place, and they would engage in different team building exercises, obstacle courses, cope courses. One of those was up by Kolob Reservoir, for those that have been up there, and they were canoeing on the reservoir. So it was my turn to drive one of the vehicles and take the youth up, and the other vehicles had been there before. This was the third trip. And so I knew that the one vehicle that had already been up there was going again, so I thought, well, I'll just follow it. I was told where to turn. The one thing I didn't realize is the pilot of that truck had changed, so the person leading me didn't really know where they were going. So as we got up there, the turn that we were supposed to take, we passed, and I thought to myself, I think that's where we were supposed to go. And I brushed it off, and that feeling came again, you need to go back. And I thought, but he was just here, certainly he knows where he's going. I didn't, I ignored that still small voice. We followed, and we went around Kolob, all the way around to the other side. And at the end, you come down kind of a steep incline, and that's where we were, and we could see across the way there were the canoes, and we weren't even close. The road didn't continue the loop. So I thought, I knew I should have listened, and I knew I should have taken that turn. So that was lesson one, not listening, which I've done far too many times. And in that moment, again, because I've spent my life on the mountains, grew up on a cattle ranch up there, I've driven all sorts of trucks and gotten unstuck in the mud, and I know how to navigate. So I thought, well, I know we can get up this hill, it's no problem. So I tried, and no four-wheel drive, it just spun out. I thought, I'm helpless here. I really feel helpless because I've done this many times before. And in that moment, I got that prompting again that you need help. And so I gathered everybody together, and then we prayed. And the thought came to me in an instant. Something I knew but had forgotten is that if we would put more weight in the back, maybe we'd be successful. So it was an SUV, kind of a Bronco type. We piled everybody in the back, got in, and up the hill we went without any problem. I felt like in that moment the Lord was giving me a do-over for not listening the first time. And it taught me a valuable lesson, not only within the gospel, but also in my temporal life, that we need to rely on the Lord. As leaders, we need to rely on the Lord in everything that we do. Now, we may have people that we work with that aren't members of the church, some that are religious and may belong to another denomination, or some that don't at all. But I think there's a universal language there when we talk about prayer and a greater power and trying to rely on something greater than ourselves. And that is so important. Okay, got number two here. Brother Gilmore, if you'll read that one.
Christ-like leaders are servants. They help, teach, and encourage those they serve. They seek to bless others as the Savior did. He doeth not anything save it be for the benefit of the world. 2 Nephi 26. They see themselves as the Lord's representatives to help others return to Him.
Thank you. So that first quote there, read that one more time, the very first line.
Christ-like leaders are servants.
Thank you. Perfect. Do we see ourselves that way, as servants? Do we get sometimes into a position, and it's okay to admit it, right? We're whether it's a calling or a position at work where, okay, I'm a step above now. I've achieved. I've made it. I'm on the way up the ladder. And does pride sometimes get in the way of that? Maybe a little bit. So I would submit to you that if you will always, in your mind, look at yourself as a servant, that you will be a greater leader. I see that now for myself, and that my attitude has changed completely in that regard, especially with work, is that it's all about serving, that we serve others now. I've got one of my lieutenants that works with me that is just the epitome of this. The title doesn't mean anything to him. He serves people every single day. And he does things sometimes that would appear to be a little bit unorthodox in the way he does it. but he is a consummate servant of these people. And some may look at that and say, well, boy, he's putting himself beneath us because he is doing such menial things that we should be doing, and it is only just elevating his stature among them. And so they look at him as someone that they would follow to the ends of the earth. And so I can't stress that enough as you go on in life, that you think about Christ and that you emulate his qualities, that you become a servant of others always, and your leadership will be without bounds. Okay, so this is an important thing. This is kind of, when we talk about leadership, I think the epitome of leadership in many ways, especially when we're given tasks, when we're given assignments. Now again, that can apply to your occupation, and it can equally apply to the gospel, especially if you're leading a group of men, of elders, or young men. So I need some participation here. So who has ever been given direction, I guess, at work? That should be everybody in here, right? What's the one burning question in your mind? So if someone says, I want you to do this, go take care of this. Now, Brother Humphrey's in the military, that may be a little different, right? When you're given an order, what do?
You instruct them, you give them guidance and direction.
That's right. So when that is given, when they say, I need you to go do this, I need it done by this time, is it our nature to go do it? Is that okay? We just go do it? No questions asked?
No. Why?
Say that again?
Why?
Now, and I know I don't want to offend any millennials in here, but is that more with our millennial group? Does that seem to be more prevalent? Because when I started out, I didn't ask that question very often. I just thought, he's the boss, he knows what he's doing, and he gave me an order, I'm going to follow it. And so I did. That's not the same way anymore. We have a group of individuals, and you could probably say this about the places you work. People want to know why, right? They want to know why you're asking me to do this. And that is crucial. That is something, again, that I've learned more and more over the last few years, is that why. Is there anything wrong with that? Yeah.
You can continue to ask that question first. Something to go along with it, and it was just that a lot of times it will also depend on the person asking you and the nature of the thing. So if my supervisor asked me to do something that they would never do, because they're above that, and I'm doing this because I'm their employee, then I would ask why more than if I'm helping them with a project, or if I know that they would do it too, but maybe they're leaving for some reason and they just need me to cover for that time.
Okay.
And so it does depend on the nature of the leader. If they're that manager that this is below me, so therefore you're going to do it, versus, okay, can we do this, or can you do this in my place?
Okay.
It makes a big difference.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a good point. Yes, for the plume.
It's a huge social change, especially anywhere where there's a free market, and anywhere where there's mostly freedom of speech. Nowadays, in any movie ever, who's mostly the bad guy? The boss. The boss is the jerk.
Yeah.
The boss is the guy who's abusing power. The boss is the guy who's messing around. The boss doesn't know anything about what he's doing. He's just there because he's been there all his, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then with the amount of social media that you have nowadays, where if a boss messes up, guess what? It's in your face within seconds.
Sure.
And so growing up, and not even growing up in it, but then having that transition happen even for people who are millennials, who are even our little older generations, they are now being more exposed to this selfish, they want control just for their own needs, manipulating the company and everything. We've been so, I would say, overexposed to it that our trust and our ability to not say why has greatly diminished. And I think we can tie it back to these Christ-like attributes of people who are doing it right and the people who we are willing to follow. It really ties back to your morals. It ties back to your faith. It ties back to your ability to be a good person outside of your function as a designated leader. And that's why it's really important for we can create change, we can create an environment where people are going to ask why less and see that everything that they're seeing around them, it doesn't have to be normal.
That is so good. Thank you so much for sharing that. You're spot on. Any other thoughts on that? I think that's important for a few reasons. And I'm not saying that anybody feels this way. I'm just speaking again from some of my shortcomings and the mistakes I've made in leadership. Oftentimes when we get into an organization and we look at a structure, right? You have a hierarchical structure, and in some places, like in law enforcement, you have a paramilitary structure. It's all about an order is given here and it just flows down. And oftentimes there's a challenge, especially from those from my generation, that we were told to do things, we did them, and so we expect that of those that are up and coming. And so it's important that we be flexible, that we learn, that we understand. It goes right back to the stuff we talked about earlier with knowing your people. Brother Humphreys talked about that. If you're gonna lead knowing these people, well, the same applies with the different generations. So the way I led a group of maybe Generation Xers would change from the millennials. And maybe I have some on my crew or in an organization on my shift that are a mix. And that creates another challenge, right? How do I lead the group? How do I put the goals out and get investment when I've got two different generations working side by side? And so understanding, putting ourselves in other people's places, empathy, and again, that key to getting to know those you lead, understanding. Because what is the one thing? I mean, if we, and again, this was a shortcoming of mine, not that I didn't understand and value the importance of family, but this was family time, this is work time, and we need to work, and we've got deadlines, and we've got projects, this needs to happen. And sometimes I didn't give thought to what's most important to that person, and that is their life, right? That is their family, that's what keeps them motivated, that's why they're there, is to earn an income to raise that family. And that should be our primary focus to the extent we can do that as leaders, is to focus in on the family and those individuals and what drives them, what motivates them. When others can relate to your cause or purpose, you are more likely to attract like-minded individuals who are eager to lend their support and advance your effort. I'll read that again. When others can relate to your cause or purpose, you're more likely to attract like-minded individuals who are eager to lend their support and advance your effort. So it's all about aligning, right? Aligning your ideas, your vision, your goal, whether you're a bishop, whether you're the prophet, whether you're a middle manager, whether you're the boss, whether you're the president. It's about getting people on board and aligning those goals and those values. Now, people may ask, right? They still may ask why, and that's okay. That's okay to have a conversation and a discussion as to why. One thing that I've done over the last few years, again, as the chief, it's my job to write policies and put those policies out to guide everybody in their actions for a couple of reasons. One is to protect themselves, sometimes from themselves, and the other is to protect the public that we serve. So the initial thought is we're going to write them. I've got the experience. I've got the training. I've got the advanced degree. I trained for it. We're going to write it. We're going to push it out. And they're going to follow it, no questions asked. And that doesn't happen, does it? So I created a policy review group of officers from different ranks, from the newest officer up to a sergeant. So when that policy is created, it gets pushed out to that group. They can review it. They can talk with their peers. They can write back and say, yeah, this is great on paper, but this isn't going to work out there. And I've got to be able to listen to that, because it's been 10 years since I've actually worked the street. And I've tried to stay in contact and work it from time to time, but things change in just a few years, let alone a decade. And so that is a way for me to plug into the power of the experts, the subject matter experts who are on the street doing the work, and who can come to me and say, yeah, this is great, but it's not going to work. And what about this and what about that? And that has caused me to make some big changes in the way that we police, which again, lends more credibility that I'm listening, but it also improves the efficiency and the service that we provide to our citizens. So it's really a win-win. So that, again, comes back to listening, to allowing others to have input, to have buy-in. And when they ask the why, we can explain the why. They may not always agree, but hopefully they'll understand the why. The most recent change, which I think was met with some resistance, and I had to explain the why a few times. Anybody ever been in an accident, a traffic accident here, that wasn't your fault? You guys are lucky. A couple? So, for many years, because our officers are sensitive, and they are human, and they try to be compassionate, would get away from writing citations. So an accident occurs, somebody caused the accident, right? Mm-hmm. Failed to yield or ran a light or whatever. They would show on the accident report form that that person was the contributor. That's the language we use, the prime contributor. But they wouldn't write a ticket. And so what we've seen over time is insurance companies who are doing all that they can, no offense, to not pay claims. Do you see that? Is that true?
Okay. It's true.
there's nothing to secure that. But a citation will change that. Mm-hmm. A citation will show this person's at fault. Okay, we've got to pay your claim. So it felt like we were victimizing people twice. They got hit, and then the insurance company, not always, but often, would not pay the claim because, well, there was no citation, even though the accident form showed who was the prime contributor.
Right, which is very unique for the state of Utah in the first place, because it is what's called a no-fault state.
Yes.
And so maybe it was 90% your fault, 10% my fault. Well, that still means we're sharing fault.
Yes.
But an officer's situation now is, okay, we have to do a citation so that there is an understanding of fault here.
Yeah, like solving an algebraic problem, right?
Yeah.
So just a quick sidebar, I'll give you an example.
Which road are we on?
So this is 400 South, and this is Main Street.
Oh, is that the one?
Peterson Plumbing is right here.
Yeah, it's on the curve.
Yeah. So one of my volunteers, he's an older gentleman, we have several volunteers that come work for us, and he's driving the speed limit north, and a car pulls out in front of him and hits him. The insurance company wanted to argue it was 50-50,
mm-hmm.
that we should pay 50 and it was shared, and I blew my top. I said, that is ridiculous. He had the right of way. She pulled out in front of him. Well, yeah, but he had time to slow down. He really had time to slow down. That was their analysis. And that's when I realized, I don't want to call it a scam or a criminal, but it does beg the question oftentimes.
It makes it difficult in the event of an accident. Just because of the way the state has some of the laws. And I think it's what you were alluding to. The state's trying to be compassionate, but when it comes down to it, somebody made a mistake.
Yeah.
Somebody, and that's why they're called accidents.
Right.
It was, the accident was someone's fault.
Absolutely. So back to the point. So the mandate I put out was that on every traffic accident where liability is clear, you shall write a citation. I took away their discretion. They didn't like that very much.
Mm.
But we brought the city attorney in. We explained why. Said, hey, this is, just put yourself in these people's shoes. If you were hit and didn't get compensation, wouldn't you feel like you wanted, I mean, you didn't do anything wrong, and you're being victimized twice. So my point here is that why. We come back to the why we do things. And again, this can apply to anything within your occupation. It can apply to the church and callings across the board. Is that why. Explain why we do something, and then give direction, and then have them return the report and hold them accountable to what you're doing. Mm-hmm. Now, some of them still don't agree, and I still hear little bickerings from time to time, third hand. But they say, okay, it's a rule. I get why. I don't agree. If it was me, I wouldn't do it, but I'll do it. And that, I guess that's worst case scenario, right? And then that's okay.
Yeah, that does bring something in my experience too. I think there honestly isn't a man in this room who one day couldn't be an elder's quorum president, a bishop,
absolutely,
state president, Every man in this room has that capacity. And I've experienced sometimes a bishop just doing his best to follow the handbook and make sure that the ward council was all aligned with their ideals and where the ward wanted to go. And there was a young women's president that would just buck that. You know, we've always done it this way, Bishop, and this is how we want to do it. But sister, the church is asking us to do it by the handbook here. Now we don't have that doesn't mean that you're mandated to do everything, but sister, you're going a different direction here. And I felt bad for the bishop on occasion because she would comply in ward council, and then on Wednesday night they were off doing other things. And so brethren, when that day comes, or if you're called to be in the young men or a primary teacher or whatever it may be, do your best to support and sustain that bishop and the programs of the church, because they come from experience.
Absolutely. Good point, President. Thank you.
Should we be worried about our young women's president?
Not
So I think it's okay in those circumstances to ask, right? I mean, we try to do our best as a new bishop to review the handbook in our meetings, so we understand the doctrine, we understand the guidelines, and then we can share that with council, so it's a group effort. But I think the bishop would agree there's nothing wrong with a member of the ward council saying, now why? I don't know if I agree, can you tell me why? And we can have an open dialogue and discussion,
right,
and have that out. It really can be detrimental. I remember years ago serving on the high council, I was over the primary, the state primary, and so we do our state baptisms. New presidency came in, and the previous president had started a little thing on the side, you know, that was not part of the handbook, and there was nothing wrong with it. But it caused this new president so much stress. He said, I just don't think I'm going to be able to do that. And so we talked. We said, well, that's not required. That's not part of the handbook. You don't have to do that. But the tradition over time just kind of got out of hand and wasn't kind of brought back in. That is critical, especially in the church, right? I mean, we have revelation, we have doctrine, we have guidance from our prophets. And it's important that be followed obediently. And again, it doesn't mean we can't ask why. In fact, sometimes we should, and many people will. We can give that why and say, here are the marching orders, so to speak. Now off we go. Joseph, do you want to read quote number 3 for us?
Jesus trusts his followers enough to share his word with them so that they can grow. That is one of the greatest lessons of his leadership. If we brush other people aside in order to see a task done more quickly and effectively, a task may get done all right, but without the growth and development in followers, that is so important.
Pause there for a minute. Has anybody ever been guilty of doing that? Yeah? Anybody want to share an example? Think about it. Yes?
I sometimes have a hard time. And so I'm like, I'll do this, and I know it might be done, but she'd be really frustrated with me. I'm
yeah.
Like, well, you could have involved. I'm like, well, I want it to be done a particular way. I'm like, well, I gotta let go. But I'm so urban.
Get smart.
Yeah, because I'm like, I like to clean from like, you know, the table, like anything that's high, and then go low, because
gotcha.
I'm just, you know, because I don't want to be getting on the floor. She's the opposite. She'll go from the ground. I'm like, but I'm still going to work on it.
That's great. Just a quick example. We had a youth gathering years ago, went to Quorum Lake, and the leaders had planned it with the youth, just you know, by the book. And we got down there, and it didn't go very well at all. It was kind of a disaster. And the leader, the young women's president, was so upset that this happened that it was a topic of conversation for weeks after. And as we got together, the consensus was, you know, yeah, it probably didn't go as we had envisioned, but it went a out fine, right? There was no problems, nobody got hurt, we didn't violate any rules, nobody committed sin, it was great. But what it did, it was it taught these youth that you can make mistakes, and you can learn from it. And as we all know, that's often the greatest teacher, right? The mistakes that we make. And so, I think that part here where it says, if we brush other people aside in order to see a task done more quickly and effectively, the task may get done all right, but without the growth and development in the followers, that is so important. So that's a great example. You know, I can sense some frustration there. I'm sure we've all had that many times. But consider for a moment, just pause and consider as you're leading an individual, what damage could be done by trying to push them out of the way and say, just let me do it. And going on and doing it versus allowing them to learn and make mistakes and fall short and using that as a teaching moment to help them get better. This is a quote that I have in my office. I've had it forever. I often look to it to make sure that I can ground myself, and that is that leadership is a gift given by those who follow. Think about that. Leadership is a gift given by those who follow. So somebody mentioned earlier titles, right? People that are put in titles to manage or to lead, and then those who are informal leaders who just lead from the front because that's who they naturally are. But consider that as a leader, that leadership is given to you as a gift by those who choose to follow you. And by earning their respect, understanding who they are, getting to know them, you'll be elevated to a true leader. So, as we work together, these words are important. I'm sure you've heard it before. Collaboration, teamwork, share, humility, constructive criticism, all those things, right? Who's ever heard, everybody's heard of the word leadership. Who in here has heard of the word and the philosophy of followership? Anybody? Did you know that existed? So I took a course many years ago. It was a 3-week course over 3 months. And we delved right into leadership. It was called Leadership in Police Organizations. And that was the first time I had heard of this concept of followership. And it's just exactly what it sounds like. That is, people that are working for leaders, that we be good followers, right? And I've often contended that the best leaders are the best followers. So think about that as you work with your team. You can collaborate, you can facilitate a discussion, but stand shoulder to shoulder with those you lead and teach them, collaborate with them, accept advice, you know, criticism, and then consider making changes in the plan if those who you lead have a better idea.
I've been kind of thinking about, because I don't lead my job right now, so I've been trying to think about how this applies to my home, and it's kind of a tough dynamic, you know, because in a lot of ways, we're supposed to lead our homes, but in some ways our wives are expected also to take some leadership, and we're expected to give it. And so I don't even know what my comment is necessarily, but I'm just kind of trying to like make it applicable, I guess, of like, you know, I think it's important that we're also willing to follow our wives a lot of times in the home and willing to, you know, communicate who has leadership at this moment over this thing, you know, over the kids, over the finances, over, you know, whatever the position is going to be, and then being willing to follow. I think that dynamic can be so tricky to navigate, you know, at home, but really essential as well.
It's a great comment. Our good bishop, if you don't know him well, is an exemplary leader in his home. He has produced remarkable children, and his wife lead in such a way. Do you want to comment on that, how you and Caprina do that together and how that works?
Well, my first comment would be, I get out of her way. You brought up a great point that we may be the priesthood leadership in the home, but when you say the best leader is the best follower, that's a great comment, that our wives have gifts and ways that they do things that maybe we don't see all the time. So there's been a lot of times in the past I come home, walk into a situation, one of my kids will come and say, your wife has been doing something such. To try to take their side at all never went well because she was on the ground seeing what was happening, and 90% of the time she was doing the right thing. And so that's my comment would be, again, just to get out of her way and trust her to do what she does best. She does things with the kids and with discipline that I just don't have the skills in, and
one of my biggest examples is my grandpa. My mom always told this story of how one time she had been doing something and her mom got after her for it. She was like wearing something that her grandma, her mom didn't want her to wear, or, you know, whatever. Because my mom, my grandma's super old-fashioned, like dress always, you know, no matter what you're doing. And I think she's just wearing something she didn't like. And so she sent her to her room, wouldn't let her go out and hang out with her friends. And my grandpa is like the most kind, loving person. You know that if grandma was getting mad that you can go to grandpa, right? And so they would always go to their dad and try to get him to get him out of the punishment that their mom gave him. And he wouldn't do it. And in this particular situation, he came into a room where she was in and he sat down and he said, "You know, I don't totally agree with what she gave you as a punishment, but I'm sticking to it because she's your mom and I love her." And that was it. You know, that was the end of the discussion. Even if the, even if he didn't agree with the punishment, he was going to stand by her because that's what you do as a team. That's what you do when you lead together.
That's great example. Thanks, Adam. Is there a hand over here? So that is key. That is so important. And I have failed in that regard on a few occasions between me and my wife, and she's let me know. A good lesson learned, because we're not perfect, right? We often comment in law enforcement that, man, people, because we see a lot of the worst, as you can imagine, and domestic violence is up, and we often comment that these people, you know, need a license to raise these kids. It's not fair that they were just, you know, they have that procreative power and they willed it so selfishly. So, you know, that's who we are. We learn as we go, and we make mistakes, and we try to do better. But we should understand, as you all mentioned, that it's kind of a co-leader position, right, with our spouse. It should always be that way. Always communicate, always collaborate, and try to draw on each other's strengths, as the bishop mentioned, to do our best to raise our family. That is so key. Okay, so if you'll continue with that last part of that, Joseph.
Jesus gave people truths and tasks that were matched to their capacity. He did not overwhelm them with more than they could manage, but gave them enough to stretch their souls.
Wonderful, thank you. So, gave people truths and tasks that matched their capacity. That's also important too. Whether it's in your home, whether it's in your, you know, Sunday calling in class, or in your occupation. Don't give people more than they can handle. Try to match their capacity. As the Lord has told us, He will not give us more than we can handle. But I like that last part, gave them enough to stretch their souls, right? It's that fine balance between not overwhelming, but we need to stretch. We need to work outside of our comfort zone and be able to stretch ourselves a little as we learn and grow and develop ourselves also. The other thing I was just going to mention briefly, which is something new that is proved valuable, is what's called the Chief's Advisory Committee. And I learned this from the St. George Chief many years ago. He's since retired. But what I do every quarter is I bring in 8 officers, no supervisors. It's the newest officer who has 1 year on all the way to the 8-year veteran. And they can advise. It's called the Chief's Advisory Committee. So they come in and we talk about whatever they want. If something was handed down that they didn't like or a decision was made that they didn't understand, because that's always a challenge too. You think it would be perfect, right? Brother Mankel, you can attest to this, Brother Humphreys. In the military, that chain of command, it's communication down and back, right? Mm-hmm. Does it always work in the military perfectly?
No.
No? I thought it did. And that's the way it is for us. You know, these supervisors, I say, you got to go communicate, because I could go down and communicate to the officers, but then I'm compromising that chain of command. And I'm micromanaging, and then the supervisors, the leaders feel like, well, why do I even do it then? Mm-hmm. So take it down and report back, return and report. But that doesn't always work. And we put so much effort into that, and it's still, we still struggle. So this is an opportunity for those to come in and say, oh, I heard it happened this way, or that this happened because of this. No, this is the truth. This is really what happened. And then they can give advice and input. And then they can share it. They can go to their peers, right? Those circles of influence. We complain about this, and we have this right. Well, then they can come to that committee, and we have an open and honest dialogue. Well, I listen, and then we react. We may made a lot of changes because of that, that have really given these guys a morale boost, which is so important in any workplace, is to make sure morale is at the highest level it can be.
Brother Adams?
Yes, Brother Humphreys.
Let me make one real quick comment. This is on an individual experience, but one person that made an influence on my life in the military, and I think maybe in a lot of other people's lives, because he became he was a scoutmaster, he was a bishop, and he was a battalion commander and an I Corps commander, and that was J. Frank Dowling. And he led by example. He, like you just made the comment about being honest. He was extremely honest. And on the flip side of being influenced for the negative side, we all know the man from Germany that was a lousy leader, and that was Adolf Hitler. Look at what he could have done if he had just been, he could have done the world a lot of good. He was just out for himself. He was selfish. He was selfish. He was a lousy leader. All of the leadership courses that I went to in the military, they always used Hitler as an example. and it's, you know, it's true. And what do we have? What do we have in the church? Bishops, counselors. I can't say much more, but
that's a great point, Brother Humphreys. Thank you for sharing. So honesty, and that's a good point, and that kind of leads us into this next thing, which sometimes is hard to do. Maybe more for others than some. So I've got two people that work downstairs. That's the face you see if you ever come to the Cedar City Police Department. They're the face of the department for the most part, other than the officers on the street. And we had one leave. This was our police support records specialist. They're secretaries, but they do so much more. So their title is certainly worthy of that. One left, we interviewed, and the one who was there, as you can well imagine, wanted somebody that she knew, because she sits, they call it the fishbowl, because we have that thick glass right there, and it's kind of like a fishbowl. She sits in the fishbowl, and she puts it with this person 8 hours a day and wants someone who she can relate to and communicate with. So we tested. I tried to hire somebody that she knew that I thought would be good, and that person declined and said, you know, I've had second thoughts, and I'm going to do what's best for my family. The next person was a male. We've never had a male in that position before, but he had great experience, retired law enforcement. I thought, he's going to do well, and she didn't like that. So I'm stuck between trying to do what's best for the organization and also what's best for the employee, and sometimes those conflict with each other. And she said, he's not going to stick around. No man wants to do this job. It's a secretary job. So we hired him, got him in. She was mad at me, which was hard because I've known this lady for years. She lives down the street from my parents, and I thought, man, this job, I hate this job. Yeah. I had those moments.
Yeah.
Well, he quit 2 months later. She was right. So I had to go to her, and I thought, how do I handle this? Because as leaders, sometimes if we admit that we're wrong, the perception in the world is that we're less credible, right? If we make a mistake and we admit that we're wrong, we're like, he's not capable to do this job then. He just lost credibility. Does anybody agree with that? Okay.
Yes.
That's the perception in the world?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, it can be, yeah.
Yeah. So I learned a lesson. I had to swallow my pride, and I thought, you know what? I can't let that. Because I've had those feelings before that I've got to try and do what's best and make the right decisions. And if I make a mistake, I really beat myself up about it. It's been something I've done for many years, and I've had to change that attitude. So I brought her up and I said, you were right. I am sorry, I apologize, I made a mistake. And she says, well, I'm over it, but I appreciate you saying that. Anyway, we just hired a new one last week. She's working out well, 3 days in. But I found that our relationship has improved immensely because I did that. Because I admitted to my mistake, I apologized, and we're rebuilding that. So many of you probably would do that without thinking about it, but just consider that, and especially in your home. I hope all of you have had the opportunity to say that to your spouse at some point, because we all make mistakes in the home, and we have to admit to it and say that we'll try to do better and commit to trying to do better. So just a quick example here. We've got about 15, 20 minutes left. I guess about really trying to lead. So we recently had, as you probably saw in the news, we had a shooting just last week. The last time the Cedar City Police Department shot at someone was, I think, back in the 70s. And interestingly enough, it was within our ward boundaries where this occurred. It was on my street where this occurred back in the 1970s was the last time we did that, which I thought was interesting. And so as you probably saw in the news, and I can't give too many details, but we showed up on a domestic call of a mother and a son who were being threatened by the father. And the more we learn about this, the more we realize that they could have been killed that night. It was, I mean, there was divine intervention in so many ways, and our officers recognized that. But one of my officers, unfortunately, was forced to shoot and kill this individual. And that was hard. That was hard for us. We trained for that. Something I think about all the time as I lay my head on my pillow each night, I think, okay, what call am I going to get next? And I got the dreaded call. Now, the fortunate part of that was nobody was hurt. Our officers weren't hurt, and everybody was safe. But somebody still lost a husband and a father. And they're doing well, considering the torture and the torment that they have suffered for so many years. So from a leadership perspective, one might think, okay, it's my job to step in and make sure that the scene is controlled and that assignments are made and that they're doing what they need to be doing and that we're getting the investigation completed and all the check boxes are marked. But that's not leadership. I mean, from my perspective and my position, what do you think would have been the most important thing for me to do in those moments? Any ideas?
Check on the officer's well-being.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's it, right? Yeah. And so that's what I did. Left the scene, went to the hospital, spent the time with him and his wife, got mental health services arranged, and then drove them to their hotel and just got them situated. It took, you know, half a day. But the impact that made and will make on him will be remarkable. He'll remember that. Had I not done that, I think he would have looked and said, well, what kind of leader is that? He stayed on the scene, okay, I get that. But he didn't come visit. And I could have assigned that, I could have delegated that to other people, but that was important for me to be there, and it was important for him to see me there to take care of that. Because having done that differently, that could have created some issues that would have been hard to unravel. So we get him on that firm foundation, we get him all the help he needs in those early hours and early days to make sure he comes back, that he's effective, that he can still serve you and our citizens effectively, and God forbid if that were to happen again, that he can do the same thing and protect life. So that was one thing that, you know, that I knew of, but I made it a point deliberately in my mind that this is what I'm going to do in this moment, and it has been remarkable for us, and to strengthen our relationship, but it has been, I think, a good example of leading, because the scene was taken care of. You know, we had that all assigned, and we have good people that do that. So the one bullet point I had here, Brother Humphrey's already talked about, and that is knowing your people. The key is knowing your people. And it's no different in the home, right? You've got to know your spouse, hopefully you know your spouse very well. You've got to know your children. You've got to have consistent, routine communications with your kids. Father's interviews and family councils and just having that open dialogue so that they feel comfortable talking to you. Hey guys.
Okay.
You don't have to, if you don't want anybody in here ever have that challenge at home. Did you guys all feel like you could speak freely with mom and dad about anything? No?
No. I hear.
Like one person?
I still can't talk to my
dad.
Really?
Yeah, I always felt when I was growing up I could talk to my mom
okay.
about just about anything, but my dad has always been so awkward about it.
Why is that, do you think?
I don't know.
I still
struggle with it.
Is he not open? Is he kind of just old school, very...
Yeah, he's pretty closed off. I think
okay.
his dad was like that,
yeah.
even worse.
Okay.
Not that I don't have a great loving
of course.
Relationship with him,
yeah.
but we just didn't talk about things.
Same with me and my dad. We're better now, but he was old
mm-hmm.
school, and my mom I could talk, but my dad I didn't dare approach about certain things, and there wasn't a lot of love shown,
mm-hmm.
you know, from him just because he didn't get that. Yes?
I had the opposite problem. I wasn't able to talk to my dad about anything, but not to my mom.
Not your
mom.
Okay. Pleasant, did you?
Yeah, well, I just experienced a lot of that same thing where I didn't feel like I think the reason why is because I was so afraid of punishment. I had older brothers that were punished and such and saw their lives, and I didn't want that. And if I screwed up, I was worried about dad finding out.
Sure. Yeah, I was the same way. I got a few boots to my rear about some of the years that helped further that thought.
Right. Looking at that and these experiences, I think, is what we draw on, so that, like we're talking today, don't make the mistakes that
Absolutely.
We've seen in the past.
Yeah.
Learn from it, grow, and do what you would expect
yes.
to do.
Absolutely. Yes.
So I'm like Peter, and I have thought for so many years why that is. I don't know why it is. And I have a really good relationship with my dad, but I've always felt just like awkward. Like it's so awkward to tell my dad things. And I think like the best thing I can come up with over the last, seriously, probably decade, just like, man, why can't I just open up to my dad in high school, you know, when I was going through whatever he needed to go through. And I think a lot of it was because I wanted him to maybe think I was better than I really was. And so it was like I wanted him to have this perception that I was outstanding. When in fact, you know, I hated school and I didn't get along with kids at school and all that. And so, I don't know. I mean, to this day, if my dad is like, are you having any problems with me? I'm like, Dad, I'm awesome.
Well, I think there's a lot of reasons for that. You know, we develop perceptions right in life, or it was handed down. But the President Reynolds is exactly right. If we get nothing from that today, is that let's not be that way. Let's make sure as we raise our kids that we have open communication, no matter what they've done, that we don't judge, that we work through it with them, that they feel like they can come to us for anything, especially in this day and age when depression and suicide is so prevalent. Oftentimes these young people see there's no other way out. And if they can't communicate with parents and see you as leaders that will collaborate and communicate and love and not judge them, we're gonna have a pretty dim future if we can't make those relationships. So please work your hardest at that. Yes, Brother Boyer.
I was just gonna say, I've seen in my dad a lot of the qualities of a good leader. Because he was always quick to admit his faults. Like, he'd come home and my mom would be mad at us, and he's like, okay, let's figure out the situation. Maybe send me to my room or something. Maybe get a little harsh at times. But then within like 30 minutes, I'm sitting on my bed crying, and he's in there just hugging me and apologizing for how he acted. Still letting me know that what I did was wrong, but that he's sorry and he loves me and he shouldn't have acted the way he did. And just, so he was really quick to apologize and recognize his own fault. And I feel like he's always just kind of a student of learning how to do things better. And it was just like, he has good leadership qualities.
And that's probably one of the biggest, just that example I gave earlier, and you just brought it up in home life, is admitting when we make a mistake, right? And seeking that forgiveness. That is key to leadership. So thank you for sharing that.
One more quick comment.
Yes.
I had a boss. When I was in leadership position, I had a general manager above me. And he was a Christian Scientist. That man could call me into his office and just chew me out and rip me a new one. And literally, I go out and fix the issue, literally 15 minutes later, it's, hey, how's it going today? And like, it never happened. And I thought, Man, if I could apply that to my own kids.
Yes.
Section 121 of the Doctrine and Covenants, reproving big times with sharpness, and then showing that greater love.
Absolutely.
And I thought, this guy has no clue what the Doctrine and Covenants even is, regardless of the section 121. But he was perfect at it. And if we could learn to do that with our children, you know, chew them out when they need to be chewed out, straighten them out, and then show that extended love and compassion to them within minutes, they realize that you love them.
Right.
And they'll straighten out.
That's wonderful. Thank you for sharing that. So, I guess the stuff we've talked about today, hopefully you've gained some knowledge, some stuff you didn't know, and maybe it's reinforced stuff you already didn't know and that you're doing very well. But as we learn these traits and these abilities, let's build on those. Brother Boyer, that's a good point about your father, a student of learning. I just want to share a quick anecdote here. And maybe some of you have heard about the old Boilermaker. I don't know if you guys have heard that. So this is the anecdote. It goes that there's this old Boilermaker who was hired to fix a huge steamship boiler system that was not working well. After listening to the engineer's description of the problems and asking just a few questions, he went to the boiler room. He looked at the maze of twisting pipes, listened to the thump of the boiler and the hiss of the escaping steam for just a few minutes, and felt some pipes with his hands. Then he hummed softly to himself, reached into his overalls, and took out a small hammer and tapped a bright red valve one time. Immediately, the entire engine system began working perfectly, and the Boilermaker went home. When the steamship owner received a bill for $1,000, he became outraged and complained that the Boilermaker had only been in the engine room for 15 minutes and requested an itemized bill. So the Boilermaker sent him a bill that reads as follows. For tapping the valve, 50 cents. For knowing where to tap, $999.50. While humorous and insightful, what this story also points is to the growing skills gap that exists. There are fewer and fewer people who know where to tap. So I would encourage you to refine your tapping skills and to know where to tap. You know, whether that's in your occupation or at home, as you gain that knowledge, that is valuable. That is worth so much to know exactly where to tap in the lives of your children, in the lives of those you lead. Once we guide, going back to that edge method real quick, once we explain, demonstrate, guide, and enable, let's get out of the way. Let's not micromanage. No one likes to be micromanaged, right? Mill doesn't have that problem. He works for himself. Maybe Rochelle micromanages.
Whatever.
That's
you want to be micromanaged, work for yourself. You see how micromanagement works.
So keep that in mind as you lead and guide your children, your family, and those you may have stewardship over at work that you teach and train. Going to probably one of the most famous quotes from our prophet Joseph Smith. What did he say? Does anybody remember?
Teach them right principles and let them govern themselves.
That's right. I teach them correct principles and then I let them govern themselves. And I would submit that is the trick and the truth to leadership. As we do that, and then we support, we sustain, we provide positive reinforcement, and we reward. That's the essence of the Lord's approach to leadership, isn't it? And I testify that that is true in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.